Paul Schrader wrote the bold and uncompromising script, Robert De Niro brought the flawless performance, and director Martin Scorsese marked himself as a serious talent to be reckoned with by using a visual language that hardwired the audience into Travis's mind, absorbing us into his disturbing perception of the world, and strangely, creating a twisted empathy. And with that, it has become one of the most influential and referenced films of all time.
All the other shots came from that concept that's in that shot right now. Envisioning all the shots, I would draw the shots on the side of the script and break it down into setups and angles and moves. And then I would take those notes and transfer them to actual drawings and storyboards.
The smoke subsides as we see the eyes of which this world is going to be siphoned through. These uncertain and paranoid eyes become all the more justifiable when we see what they see. New York, but not quite as we know it. Through a process called chemtone, we see the streets in a very high contrast with extremely blown out colours. The result is a luminescent world, but at the same time one that's overwhelmed by darkness. This is a perfect metaphor for how Travis views his world, because even though there is just as much light, he chooses to focus on the darker aspects. The smoke and slow motion give the streets a more monstrous and sentient quality. Through the imagery alone, these streets are pictured to be menacing. What we have in this opening is the skew perspective of our main character. Travis is exceptionally biased on his outlook of the world, which is important as the rest of the movie is to be examined through this haunted gaze. In the introduction, some themes have already been established, that Travis appears distant from reality, and he sees the world differently to us. Travis enters the depot with the smoke from outside following him, as though he's exiting from his own personal hell. It's in the depot that we get our first look at Travis, as well as the off-kilter shooting style that this film presents us with. Here's a very ordinary scene, but there's something off about the framing and positioning of the camera. In terms of composition, both shots are slightly off-center. In most movies, the focal point would in fact be Wizard. But here's what we learn about Taxi Driver. As a first-person narrative, we have to analyse things from the mind of Travis. This is what Travis notices, not the standard behaviour right in front of him, but the confrontation in the background of his world. While his attention should be directed towards his boss, he decides to only view the world's ugly side. Now, even though this scene is only our first legitimate scene, there's a lot of themes established here that continue for the rest of the movie. From the get-go, Travis is constantly isolated, showing us the key theme of loneliness. In the depot, he's separated from Wizard by a glass window, the same way he's estranged from the rest of the world in his cab. It keeps him shielded from the outside world, and even when with Fares, Travis only looks at them through his mirror. He ensures that he keeps his distance, showing us just how removed he is from the world. This scene shows us Travis getting a job with the taxi company, and it also features the first overhead shot, which will be explained at the end of this analysis. However, at this point, I'd like to bring up something that's very important to the movie's style. A lot of people notice that even when compared to other Scorsese films, there are certain points in Taxi Driver where the techniques of the film become very intrusive. The closest definition I could think of for this style is emotional filmmaking. By this, I mean that the camera works in a very specific way. Not in the way that, say, the camera works in a Kubrick film, where you have to decipher the symbolism of the camera from an anthropological or more symbolic perspective, but from an emotional point of view. This happens for the duration of Taxi Driver. In these opening scenes, when Travis becomes agitated, the camera moves in and things become more claustrophobic.
If you're gonna break my chops, you can take it on the arches right now, you understand?
Sorry, sir, I didn't mean that.
Outside the depot, there's a dissolve, which typically is used to move ahead in time, yet simply brings Travis closer to us, almost suggesting that the film and Travis aren't quite in sync, and that Travis isn't in tune with the world. It's this emotional filmmaking perspective that's vital to explaining Taxi Driver, because the film tells the story of Travis's inner turmoil, so a lot of these techniques aren't to be explained on a precise symbolic level, they just feel right. A symbol that he hopes to die in infamy through his three murders, and that deep down, he knew everything leading up to this was brought on himself. The overhead shot tracking through the building was the only shot written in the script. Paul Schrader described it as the eye of God, as this is the movie's first real objective look at this insanity, breaking the trend of seeing things through the eyes of Travis. This overhead shot is the culmination of all the other overhead shots we've seen through the film. Travis taking the job, the bad diet and lifestyle, pursuit of a partner, using violence as a solution. Combining all of these shows that Travis brought this on himself. As a spectator, we now move away from Travis's perspective, as things are shown without being filtered by his own prejudice, and the camera slowly drifts out of the building.
And what's crazy is that the scripts for every episode of Metastasis is a word-for-word translation of the episodes of Breaking Bad, so if it's pretty much the same, it can't be bad, can it? It's shit. This is a perfect example of how important direction, cinematography, and editing are to a series. Look at the meth in this scene.
Acá hay cristales de 4-5 centímetros. Esto es puro vidrio, profe. Esto es arte.
It's opaque, though. In Face Off, when Walt asks the neighbor to get into his house, in the original, we never leave Walt's car. In Metastasis, we follow the neighbor that we have zero attachment to. The final shot of the original is this gorgeous zoom-out shot going upwards, from a close-up of Walt's face to a wide of Walt's dead body with officers surrounding him. There's even a bluish light on Walter. Meanwhile, in Metastasis, it's also a zoom-out, but it's diagonal, never really feeling grandiose, and if we use these two shots to represent the quality of these two shows, I'd say that's fitting.
The 1977 thriller Sorcerer is an adaptation of director Georges Arnaud's French novel The Wages of Fear, and tells the story of four vastly different men tossed about by fate and fighting to retake control of their own destinies when given a dangerous opportunity, only to find that they're in less control of their lives than they ever thought possible. But even the slightest jostle could kill them in an instant. Ahead of them lies 200 miles of rough road and, at the end of it, enough money to release them from this purgatory and return to better lives. Unlike director Henri-Georges Clouseau's 1953 adaptation of The Wages of Fear, Waylon Greene's script for Sorcerer is less about the effects of capitalism and greed, and more about whether anyone truly has control over his or her own life. Each of these men is running from their doom to some degree, yet continually pulled back toward death no matter how hard they struggle. This is Fate. In its filmmaking style, characters, score, and underlying themes regarding the forces beyond our control, Sorcerer ponders whether we have any true power over our own fates, and definitively, aggressively answers, no. Fate has no sympathy. It takes no rest. Likewise, the pace of Sorcerer and Friedkin's direction do not know rest or care. Before setting its characters off on their journey, the first hour of Sorcerer is focused on their life in Latin America. The fictional town of Porvenir has no specific country, no exact real-world counterpart, but the involvement of an American oil company that looks past a dictatorial government and extreme poverty reflects truth. Friedkin lingers on the dirt and the sweat. The inability to escape the gaping maws of poverty. This is Purgatory. Its central characters have been cast here for their sins and bide their time as penance, while caught in a limbo between the life they once lived and the deaths from which they are running. The four weary characters stay in the Purgatory of Porvenir can be equated to what Camus calls the act of eluding. This is a journey of 200 miles, but every step feels like a fight when there's dynamite strapped to your back. Close-ups by cinematographers John M. Stevens and Dick Bush show us the sweat pouring off our leads, feet punching the gas and brake, hands grappling with constantly shifting gears. It's unrelenting, and it only gets worse as the world itself seems determined to destroy our characters. At the time I made the film, said Friedkin, I felt that the world had come to a crossroads, where the major powers would all blow apart if we didn't pull together. Life is actually a beautiful gift, but people regard it not as something that is vulnerable, but as something that they take for granted. Green's script has no foreshadowing of what's to come, no shift in pacing to hint toward a treacherous twist. The way that Friedkin and his editors cut the film rams straight into the next obstacle without slowing down, and as soon as one danger has been bypassed, the film immediately cuts to the next situation without a pause for breath. When its characters celebrate or reminisce, they find themselves in even worse danger because they mistakenly believe that the world has given them a break. Late in the film, our two trucks come to a fork in the road and go their separate ways. Jackie and Nilo feel like they made the right choice, but are quickly forced to drive over a rope bridge in the middle of a storm, carefully guiding the tires across slowly breaking planks. It's a death-defying, harrowing sequence, but they make it. They celebrate, and we as an audience feel like we can breathe again, only to smash cut to Manzone and Kassem at the same bridge. It didn't matter what path they took. Fate led them to the same place. Crossing a more broken bridge in an even worse storm fries the nerves of both character and audience as we repeat the fight to survive with even worse circumstances. It's not a coincidence that when the worst seems behind them, it's Sorcerer that explodes from a blown tire. This tinge of supernatural is underlined by the haunting electronic score by Tangerine Dream. Its inorganic feel creates an ethereal atmosphere. At times, it enforces its character's bravery. At others, it feels like a shrieking demon casting a spell. Large swaths of the film go unscored, instead focusing on the sounds of the jungle and the people toiling away. When it does kick in, Tangerine Dream's music makes moments like the reveal of the burning oil well, or the creation of the trucks feel monumental and almost spiritual. Possibly even more frightening than the idea of fate is that this cruel, terrible, deadly journey is simply the result of an indifferent world. This is death. It's all around us. This is fate. It has no care for us. What comes at Sorcerer's very end is not so much a final, cruel twist, but the world's final assertion of its power over all our lives. No matter how hard we fight to survive, the next struggle still awaits us. This is the world.